Here, I don't know. Gosh, here, have the entire couch.
Oh,
you want to lie down and
take a nap.
Come into my.
It's gonna be like therapy.
I'll be the therapist today, which is the theme of the book, right?
So yeah, I really.
Hey, everybody.
So
good morning. Thanks for doing this. Yeah, come in. I love these couches. So I think, and this is finally a couch long enough for me.
It's so yellow. I love it.
So, Maulik, I want to acknowledge, first of all, congratulations. This is the book cover for the
what
best
did you do
at
with
it,
the book?
Maulik Pancholy. My wonderful colleague, Nahara Acharya, wanted to have this book and to save this, but I had to read the book, and so I've been carrying it around. So I said, hold the book cover while I wait. And then, of course, I lost the book last night at dinner. And I'm 9 pages from finishing it. So I'm very irritated because it's got me all wrapped up in the sort of soap opera of this young man, Rahul. So my first question, this is impossible. Are you Rahul?
You know, it's so funny. It's like the number one question I get asked. So
okay,
just
then let's
to
not
like,
ask that.
Well, no. I feel like people are probably interested. Yeah. And hopefully when they read the book, people will be interested. So just to like fill people in. So the book is about a 12-year-old Indian American kid named Rahul Kapoor, who's just beginning to realize that he might be gay. He's not sure, but he's certainly being bullied about it at school. And he has a lot of anxiety around both his cultural identity and his sexual identity, and it plays out for him with obsessive compulsive like behaviors. And one night his grandfather, who's like his favorite person in the whole world and who is one of my favorite characters in the book, Bai, which means older brother, He kind of sees this behavior, and he tells Rahul this story, and at the end of the story, Rahul feels like if he's just the best at something, all of his other problems will disappear. So he sets off on a mission with his best friend Chelsea to find this thing that he's going to be the best at and to prove to the world, essentially, that he's worthwhile. And so, yes, I think Rahul, there's so much of Rahul, so much of me in Rahul. He's definitely a fictional character, but I was that kid who sort of, I think, tried to do a million things and tried to prove myself in an effort to hide away from so many of the things that I didn't like about myself and so many of the things that I think the world was sort of telling me were going to be problematic, which were my identity, which, you know, my identity is on multiple levels. So.
You know, I love the book, and so congratulations. So the part where, you know, it will move you to tears in part, various parts, but one of the things that was really caught me at the beginning, and it just showed me how powerful this was, a journey for a young person reading this, was the story of his grandmother. Mm. And so when Bai is talking about his, you know, future wife, having been in India, I guess a mathematician or a scientist, basically.
She went to engineering school.
Yeah. And then having been told by numerous people that, oh, they didn't want that one who was the best in the class because she didn't, you know, fit all this, and that she overcame this.
Yeah.
So for those of you, this isn't like to be inside baseball, but I think that it was a very powerful vignette. Can you share that with us?
Yeah, I can. It's so funny because I have family down in D.C., and I was staying with my mom last night and my sister, and we were talking about this story because the grandmother is very much based on my mom. So I aged her up, which most women are like, yes, please age me up in the story you tell. I made her the grandmother. But my own mother was the first woman in her village in India to go to engineering, to go to America and also to go to engineering school. And she encountered a lot of pushback for being a woman who wanted to go into the sciences at a time when women were supposed to get married and stay home and have kids. Which, to be honest, I think that we've come so far culturally, but I would say that there's still a lot of biases around that. And when you look at certainly at organizations, mm-hmm. which I'm sure that people you have later on today will be able to speak about this far more intelligently than I will, but if you look at corporate structures, we see that there are a lot of women in the workplace, but at the higher and higher up you go, like there seems to be fewer and fewer women, and that's problematic. But in the book, the grandfather tells the story to Rahul about how his grandmother was the first woman to go to engineering college, and all the men in the school made her life really hard because they didn't want to have a woman in the class, but that when she was the best in her class, they had to respect her. Mm. And that's the story that Rahul leaves being like, well, if I'm just the best at something, people will have to respect me. And the thing that I think is complicated, and hopefully I've allowed that nuance to be in the novel, is that we do need to strive to be the best, I think, and it's good to win. And proving ourselves is, I think, part of, you know, moving ahead in whatever careers we're in, but it shouldn't be that takes that that's covering up who we are. Like, women shouldn't have to work harder to become CEOs than men have to. They shouldn't have to prove themselves. Rahul shouldn't have to be the best at something for kids to like him. He should be able to be himself and his authenticity and still be liked.
So when there was another moment in the book when I'm reading it, and it's an incredible story where you deal with bullying, you deal with identity, you deal with how friendships are formed and how they fall apart. And then I'm feeling like I really want everyone in Congress to read this book. I want the guy over in the White House to read this book.
The guy.
Because when you look at it and read it, it's really a story that also has a lot of relevance to adults, I think. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And we deal with bullying. I mean, we're looking at bullying at schools and the impact. But there's also a hell of a lot of bullying that goes on, intimidation, harassment. And we see this playing out every day. And so I'm just wondering, are you interested in this being used as a greater comment beyond school kids?
Yeah, that's a really good question. You know, in the world of publishing, they before the book comes out, they send out advanced copies, and those advanced copies go to adults. They don't go to kids. And so the book just came out 2 weeks ago, October 8th. So it's now getting into the hands of kids in a way that it wasn't before. But the immediate response, or the initial response, rather, was from adults. And it was, like, incredible. You know, like, I was getting calls from people that were like, a woman told me that her brother came out to her as an adult, and had she had this book in middle school, she would have known how to talk to him and known what he was going through. Mm. I'm doing an adult book club here back in DC, where a mom was like, I want all my friends to read this book, and will you come speak at a book club? And I think part of it is that, you know, this story about a kid struggling with his identity, we've seen it from certain perspectives, but we haven't seen it from the perspective of Rahul Kapoor, who happens to be a 12-year-old Indian American gay kid. I think most kids and most adults, honestly, struggle with feeling different and feeling like we need to fit in. I have certainly in recent weeks been at parties where I'm sitting in the corner being like, oh my gosh, I'm the weirdo in the room. Or, you know, we all struggle with that. And I just think that having this unique perspective allows us a way in to talk about it. But yes, I do hope that adults read the book. I mean, I love middle grade novels. I love YA books. And I think part of it is that when we are like 12 or 13, we rub up against things in our lives that become the things that we rub up against for the rest of our lives, in a way. You know, these struggles come up that we are constantly having to find our way around. And so, yeah, I would love it if adults find a connection to the book.
You and I were just talking about our mutual friend Michael Urie, and you're going to be performing with him at the Helen Hayes Theater in Broadway after this is all done. And it also struck me, you come out of a profession, you know, with 30 Rock, the various shows you've done, where you're surrounded by people. And we used to always think that was cool and glitzy, and you're a TV star and all of that. But we're learning, really through folks like Ronan Farrow and others, how creepy and how awful some of the backstories are in your world. Yeah. And I'm interested in, now that you're writing about sexual identity of young people and how really one of the characters, Brent, was trying to weaponize, you know, some of that knowledge, I'm interested in how you see your world and what we who are not part of that should be worried about, should know about.
Do you mean like the entertainment industry, yeah, like in particular? Yeah, you know, it's so interesting because I feel like the world of the theater and sort of like the backstage life of so many shows there's such a camaraderie, and there's, you know, what we're doing, I think, requires an amount of vulnerability and an immediate intimacy too. You know, like, especially if you're guest starring on a TV show and you have like a big emotional scene, the way it normally works is you walk onto set, you say a few hellos, you read the scene once with the other actor, then you read it again for the camera crew, and then you're basically filming it. And so you're building like emotional connections right away. And I think that with that, you know, you're putting yourself in vulnerable situations, and certainly we've seen this play out where people take advantage of other people's vulnerabilities. And just to speak about like identity, it's like, it's so interesting because I think like actors, like we're so open in a way, and there's always been this dichotomy, especially for the LGBT community, of sort of being one person on set and being another person in public life. Mm. And we're seeing that change for sure. But I also feel like when we talk about openly gay actors, we can count them like you know, on maybe a hand or two. Mm. And I think the same thing, you know, revolves around, like, you know, people say, like, you wrote a book about diversity. There's increasing diversity on television. I'm like, yeah, let's talk about the TV shows that have a lead character of color. And again, it starts to become like a thing where the numbers are not reflective of the world we live in. So I think we could be doing better on so many levels. And like you said, like entertainment, like we're in a unique position because people watch TV. Do you guys watch TV? Mm-hmm. Yeah, people watch TV, and people, and we're emotionally connected to it. Like, these people that we watch on TV are in our lives for a long period of time, and so there's a lot of, I think, power in the storytelling that we put out there.
You were a member of the President's Advisory Commission on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders during the Obama administration.
Yeah.
You, in a dramatic moment, resigned from that.
Yes.
Can you tell us why?
Yeah, so I served on this commission under Obama, and our terms technically went until September of 2017. Do I have that date right? So we could have stayed on in this commission under under Trump. I think there were 20 commissioners, and I think 17 of us resigned, I believe was the number. Everybody had their own particular reasons. For me, my focus while I was on this commission was working on anti-bullying issues for the Asian American and Pacific Islander community. And part of the task of the commission was to increase access to federal programs. So we literally were supposed to go out and say, if you're being bullied, you should report it to the Department of Justice, and here's how the government can help you. It was sort of the job of the commission. And early on in the Trump administration, I talked, I think it's okay to say this, but I had a conversation with someone at Mayor de Blasio's office in New York about how we would like to partner with them on their Respect for All Week in schools. And the pushback was that having this listed as a White House anti-bullying campaign didn't fit the kind of messaging that they wanted to put out for their Respect for All Week. And so what became really clear to me is that this White House label, which had allowed us to do so much work in the past, was actually going to become a hindrance to continuing the work. And then, you know, it's just like the optics around going to a Muslim American kid and saying, hey, if you're being bullied at school for your religion, you can come to a government agency. At the same time, the government was instating a Muslim ban. It just felt like completely disingenuous. So that was, for me, that was the...
I mean, that really takes me to the question, because I'm sure you're now beginning to meet moms and talk to kids, and you're probably going to hear stories where this you know, made a real difference. But I worry, you know, in a way, that what else needs to happen? So you've given... I think you wrote the book in a way because you said in that literature out there, you didn't see yourself.
Yeah.
You didn't see the kind of young person that you were at that time. What is the responsibility that you think the rest of us have to fill in that space for the young kid that who wasn't in the book, and to deal with those children that may have anxiety issues, that may be being bullied, that are having a hard time evolving in this climate?
Yeah, I, you know, in the book, so there's a thing in middle grade literature where often the kid is left alone, like the parents are very absent, and it's all about the kid on this journey. And this is certainly Rahul's journey, and he has to find for himself who he's going to be. And he's a 12-year-old. Mm-hmm. We were talking about this earlier. I don't think he has it all figured out by the end. I think as an adult, we can be like, oh, you got to get to that thing. But he's a 12-year-old, and I wanted to honor that. But for me, I didn't want to write a book where the kid was just left out on his own to figure everything out. Like, he has allies. He has a best friend who stands by him. He's got this grandfather who, in a way, I think misinforms him and tells him the wrong lesson, trying to help him. And the grandfather, too, has to go on a journey to realize that you don't always have to be the best at something to be the best. There's a conversation around the obsessive compulsive behaviors that he has with his dad, where I don't think the dad has all the language. It's like an awkward conversation. He comes up to Rahul's bedroom and sees that the bed is pulled away from the wall so that the outlet won't touch the bed skirt. And he goes to push it back in, and Rahul freaks out and is like, don't push the bed back, don't push the bed back. And they have this conversation. So I say all this to say that the conversation is what feels so important to me, that even if we don't know how to have it, even if it's going to be messy, even if we don't have all the words, that having that conversation is so important. And so part of doing a middle grade book, I'm in the middle of a massive book tour. I think I've been like in 9 cities in the last like 2.5 weeks. But part of that tour is going to middle schools And so I'm literally like doing assemblies of like 700 kids or a little writer's workshop with 20 kids. And these kids are remarkable and they're really willing to open up. You know, I say like the book's about a kid who feels different. Have any of you ever felt different? And like hands go up. And these, you know, this one kid was like, I have alopecia, and kids make fun of me for having no hair. One kid was like, I have ADHD and I'm short. Mm. You know, so this idea of like, so it's like this idea of like multiple identities somehow being owned by, you know, we don't even know what their identity issues are. So just, I think just being open to talking to them about it is so important.
I want to go to all of you for a question or two in just a moment, but the last question I have is there's another powerful part in the book where I think it's Chelsea and Rahul are talking, and Rahul is confessing that he wants to, he not only has a crush on this young boy, Justin, but he wants to be Justin.
Yeah.
You know, he has dreams and fantasies about like getting longer arms or like becoming Justin. And Chelsea goes, but what's wrong with yourself? Why don't, you know, why not be you? And it raises this question for me, because I think in there, as we're thinking about diversity and inclusion and what frames we should use, and are we trying to be something other than what we are? I'm interested, you know, we'd be here all, you know, morning talking about this subject. What do you think we can do better than most diversity and inclusion conferences or discussions do? What are the blind spots in this discussion? As I found that something that made me think differently in that reading that part of your book and said, huh, that's a very interesting insight where people, you don't want people to be different than they are. We need to meet each other where we're at and find a way to embrace one another. But but how do you think we can improve the kind of discussion we're having?
Well, this idea where Rahul sees this, you know, this guy that he finds attractive who happens to be straight and white and more athletic than Rahul. But he also is like, has this idea that if he was just Justin, his life would be easier. To be honest, like, it's definitely a way I move through the world as a young person, and also a part of myself that feels really vulnerable to reveal in the book, because I think it's like a little confusing, and I think that that in all that messiness is where the confusion for so many young gay men lies, because we have so much messaging that you have to be this person, and so we think it's hard to understand the feelings, you know? And so a big part of the book was like creating language, I think, around feelings that feel confusing as a kid, because I had no idea. And because I had that mindset, I had told myself that I was actually straight for so long, that I just wanted to be like the straight guys, and that the attraction felt so confusing. So I would just say, I think in answer to your larger question about what are the blind spots, like, it's, everything is so complicated. And I think part of the reason I took a risk of revealing something that feels really personal, even like the OCD behaviors, like very, I'm really good at hiding it. So very few people know about like why I disappear into the other room to check the lock 3 times. You know, that it's like, oh, I'll be right back. Like, I'm really good at hiding it. But I felt like it was important to talk about, because there are other people who are struggling with it and could maybe benefit by seeing that story reflected back. So I would just say, in terms of the blind spots, that it's incumbent upon all of us to be a little risky and to share a little bit of stuff that might make us feel uncomfortable in an effort to improve the situation. And that we have to be, I think, courageous about doing it, but also like creating space in which other people can be courageous.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Neil, before, any questions, comments from the floor? You all don't know the book yet. Tonight at 7 p.m., you're going to be at
Politics and Prose, on Connecticut Avenue. I think it's going to be a really, really fun event. I'll be signing books, obviously, but I'm doing it in conversation with Gautam Raghavan, who I worked with during my time at the White House, and he was President Obama's liaison to, amazingly, both the AAPI and LGBT communities. It's interesting that those...
Are you going to send a copy to President Obama?
Oh my gosh, thank you for the idea. See, this is how ideas happen. Thank you. Yes. I'm going to send this cover. I'm going to be like, you don't need the book.
I got to tell you, getting President Obama tweeting out, wow, well, read this book. You know, you don't have to do all these books.
Well, he's big on the lists now, right? Yeah. There's like the playlists and the summer reading lists. And, you know, hey, thank you.
No, he tweeted out a book called Truth Decay. It's not Tooth Decay, but Truth Decay. And it's a wonky book about the collapse of reporting and whatnot. It's a Rand Corporation book written by a friend of mine there. and no one was ever going to buy this book. And then it became a bestseller from that way.
Oh my God.
Does your husband like the book?
Oh my gosh, he loves the book. The thing that he, I think he finds a little
challenging. Is he one of the characters in the book?
That's so funny. I think he would like to think that he's the Justin character. Because Justin's like the cool guy. Although I just have to throw out there that Justin ends up being not the coolest guy at the end, which I think is everyone's discovery. You know, we all have that moment where you look back and you're like, why did I ever feel that way about this person? They are so not cool. I was going to say that I think the thing that is, because I'm on this tour, and because so much of tour is like going to cities where you actually know people, he's been like jetting around the country a lot with me. And I think he's like, all right, enough of the book already. No, he's super supportive.
And the bully in the book is a guy named Brent.
I'm
sure we all have had Brents. I certainly had Brents when I was growing up, and also dealing out with my own gay feelings at that time, and was harassed in some ways. Did you ever reconcile with whoever your Brent was?
I don't think I had like a particular Brent. Brent's sort of an amalgamation of like a couple different people. I feel like, this is going to sound terrible, but I feel like the reconciliation, honestly, is just about like feeling comfortable in myself, and then occasionally seeing some people on Facebook and being like, wow, your life didn't turn out so great. That's terrible. That is terrible. That's terrible to say. I love them all. I love them all.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I just want to say, read this book. This is really, really great. Let your kids read the book. I was reading it over the weekend, and I have a fantastic colleague at The Hill, Nahara Kacharya, and I tweeted her and I said, oh my God, you're Maulik Pancholy's mom. Because the mom you describe in there is, and then Naharik writes what it says, all Indian moms are the same. But it's a fascinating journey into a lot of different worlds. Thank you so much for it, because it really made my weekend. The best
Thank
at
you.
It, Maulik Pancholy. Congratulations. We look forward
Thank
to seeing
so
how
much.
It does. Thanks so much. And tomorrow night, 7
Thank
o'clock,
you.
Or no, tonight,
tonight
7 yeah. o'clock, Politics and Prose. If you want to have more and buy the book, we'll have it there. So thank you so much for joining
Thank
us.
So much.
Thank you.